Good evening, everybody. Thank you all for coming, all of you who made it. Well, it's my great privilege and honor, one, to be sharing the stage with Devdutt Pattanaik, and also to be invited and become part of this event by GB. So great thanks and gratefulness to GB and for Sopan for putting this all together. So our conversation is going to be about the book, but also I think what Devdutt is going to do is also take us through the journey, as it says over here. So we wanted to, okay, so there's a global discourse in the queer circles that religion typically tends to be adversarial to queer rights and LGBT rights. So typically in the West, for instance, there is this argument, you know, that if you're a Christian bakery, you will not bake gay cakes or for like, you know, cakes for gay weddings. So there's this constant tussle between society and religion that's happening in the West. And so LGBT rights typically has been about expunging religion from the domain of rights and from the domain of, you know, dignity and conversation of human experiences. And so when we were thinking about how do we conceptualize this book, one of the ideas that I thought of was that this book is about recasting religion from an adversary to an ally. And the reason I wanted to recast it that way is because religion is a very important part of all of our experiences and all of our lives, but especially it is important to our parents and, you know, people who care about us, because it adds a certain legitimacy in our social lives. So whether or not the law says, and Devdutt likes to, you know, quote this one line that he said in a workshop in Delhi, he said, as long as your mom accepts you, it doesn't matter what the Supreme Court says or what the law says, right? I mean, as long as your mother says, I am okay with you. And that's really the dignity that we seek. You know, we seek this level of validation from our family and from our friends and our well-wishers. And religion plays a big role in how that validation comes about. So we wanted to have this book that, you know, goes into making religion, especially Indian religions, as a friend and ally to our lives and to our experience. So we contrast religions largely across the world into two things. One is the Abrahamic faiths, which include Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. And they are Abrahamic faiths because they all come from, you know, the religions of Abraham and therefore Yahweh. And we contrast that with the karmic faiths that we see in the subcontinent of India, where we have Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and Sikhism. These are called karmic faiths because one of the most fundamental principles that run across them is the idea of karma and reincarnation and rebirth. So that's the contrast between. So it's one life religions and these are multiple life religions.
So just to put this in context, this book, if you know, and if you all have seen this book, says the basis was how do Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism and Hinduism affirm the dignity of queer identities and sexualities. Now around the world, when you use the word religion, people typically refer to the one life faiths or the Abrahamic faiths,
right?
So they typically are referring to Christianity, they're referring to Islam, they're referring to Judaism,
right?
Around the world. So if you go to Europe, America, anywhere in the world, when the moment you use religion, they by default refer to the Abrahamic faiths.
Yeah.
And it was important to highlight that more than a billion, maybe 2 billion, 3 billion people around the world are not thinking like this. There is the Buddhists, for example, across Japan, across Southeast Asia, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Burma, all these countries, India, all of these countries, majority of the population are not aligned to this way of thinking. So when you use the word religion around the world, one has to make people sensitive to the fact that there are many types of religion. And within the different types of religion, there are different religions like Judaism, Christianity. So when people use the word like God, they think it is one meaning across. And it was very, very important. That's part of my work. And, you know, that sort of brings me to how this book happened.
So just to give you a context of why this book came about, okay? So in 2015, a historic panel discussion took place at the Global Festival of Theology held in Sweden. It's called the Global Festival of Theology. Its objective was to examine what the sacred texts of the Abrahamic faiths, namely Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, had to say about human sexuality. Now, by bringing into perspectives from the karmic faiths of Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, and Hinduism, which together represent the beliefs of almost a third of the world's population, this book, I Am Divine, So Are You, expands a conversation between world religions and human sexuality to a truly global level. The theology of karmic faith is revealed at the intersection of scripture, culture, rituals, and lived realities, and hence they are dynamic and amenable to multiplicity of perspectives. So this is a landmark book as it casts religion, especially for karmic faith, as an ally and not an adversary of queer emancipation. And it does significantly informs the secular and legal movements across the world for LGBT rights. So this is basically the introduction, the blurb of the reason for the book. Devdutt will get more into how it came about and the people involved. But so just wanted to get across this idea that there are two different kind of schools of thought in terms of global religions, but the conversation was predominantly dominated by this side of the conversation. Sure. So one of the tensions in these two schools of thought, in these two perspectives, is that basically Abrahamic faiths are all about one life theologies, right? So it's just this one life that you have, and you have to make the best of it, or if you screw up with it, then you're, you know, punished for eternity. And the idea is to either align to God's law, which has tension with these ideas of what is God's love about. So these faiths typically tend to go over their scriptures, over the Bible or the Quran or the Torah, to explore either two things. One, whether we are in alignment with God's law, whether our lives, our behaviors, our values are in alignment with what God wants us to be, or whether we try to see permission from God's love and mercy to live the way we want to live. But it's always trying to find what the book says, or what God says, what God wants out of us. In contrast, karmic faiths, because they are about rebirth and they are about multiple lives, the major tension there is about, well, what do you do with this life that you have? Yes, you'll have multiple lives, but they all will have consequences that you have to bear. So the consequence of living in a world with the household, with a family, with marriage, with children, what does that lead you to do? Versus the idea that, especially in Buddhism and Jainism, is let's not engage with the world, let's try to withdraw and become a hermit, become a monk. That way you are not part of the causality, the karmic causality that pushes you towards multiple births. That's this conversation happening here. And we'll get into much more detail later.